Have you wondered about living elsewhere after you retire? Well, we have, almost daily. As you know, it's not an overnight decision. Hi, this is Gil.
And Jean.
Of Retire There, a podcast about places to consider living in during your retirement. We started this show for selfish reasons. We will be retiring in the next few years, but we're not sure where. Then a light bulb went off in Jean's head. He asked, what are others doing? With so many baby boomers retiring, there must be many relocating. Let's connect with them and pick their brains. But first, a little background about us. I'm Asian, born in Brazil, and raised in Brooklyn. I'm an engineer turned attorney and practicing higher ed law at a college, and I love working with students, faculty, and staff. And now, I'm a podcaster.
All right. I'm not Asian. Born and raised in Long Island, New York, a place I've always wanted to leave. I'm a law librarian working in a court who loves his job. We've lived in Bay Ridge, Brooklyn, New York for many years, and have been thinking about our future home.
So we will be speaking to folks from around the world who have moved to venues of their dreams and more. And we will share their intimate secrets.
Whoa!
Just kidding! We will offer information you may not find anywhere else, though, so stay tuned. In today's episode, we will chat with Lisa Van Sand and Everett Harlow, who relocated to Sarasota, Florida. U.S. News and World Report just ranked Sarasota as the number one best place to retire in 2021. TripAdvisor rated Sarasota's Siesta Key Beach as the top beach in the United States in 2020. Wow, that's amazing. The top beach of the millions of beaches that exist in the U.S. And here's a fun fact. Ringling Brothers and Barnum and Bailey Circus spent their winters in Sarasota, which led to the famous museum housing a lot of their wares and costumes. So that's got to be a sight.
Yeah, I have a question about that later, but that'll be for later.
Okay. A little background about our guests. Lisa is a native New Yorker, a Brooklyn Tech High School alum, yay, and attended Grinnell College in Iowa. She characterizes her career as mosaic, overall in catering, working for, and owning, and has performed editing work. Currently, she's actively investing. Lisa trades currencies on the foreign exchange platform known as Forex. Oh, that scares me. I'm quite the opposite, Lisa, a disciple of J.L. Collins. That's me. Lisa explains that she learned to trade options and futures 15 years ago and is passionate about empowering people, especially women, to manage their own finances. Lisa loves financial education and personal development. Her interests include cooking, making soap, that's cool, talking about trading, and relationship coaching.
Everett is from Sacramento, California, and attended California Baptist College. He had his own business in graphic design and art reproduction. These days, he's busy making and repairing guitars. Everett's dream was to be a luthier, and that's what he's getting to do now. He also plays at a local radio station monthly and enjoys building furniture. Wow, I'm jealous. Today, they enjoy kayaking, cycling, and shibari, otherwise known as Japanese rope suspension. Whoa.
That's not us, Gene. I can barely hold the rope. All right, guys. So thank you so much for joining our show and for sharing your story. Take us away to Sarasota. How did you decide to move there? I know initially you mentioned that you had a family member down there, but then you decided to stay. So tell us.
Yeah, my sister moved down here. She was doing the snowbird thing with her husband. He died suddenly, and I came down and spent a few months with her one winter and got a job at a local cheese shop, part of my mosaic career. I was a cheesemonger at the cheese company. And it really matched my skills as a chef with the catering company. So people would say, oh, I'm having a dinner party. What cheeses should we start with? That kind of thing. So I really loved that job, and the shop was really interesting. But having been here for 4 months, Ev came down and visited, and we really loved it. And I was like, we should move down here. He's like, no, we're too involved at home. We can't do it. We, at the time, we were living with my dad and his new wife, not too new. Yeah. They met when they were in college, after my mom died, and after her husband died, she sought out my dad, looked him up. They got married. He was 87 and she was 6.
Such a great story.
Yes. And they were married for 11 years, but at one point they became too much like teenagers, like not understanding the consequences of their actions, like driving and climbing up ladders. And so, and cooking, that was, became a dangerous thing as well. So we moved in with them and we were living in their basement in, I don't know, 400 square foot room. We realized that they weren't accepting our help very well. So we decided to talk about assisted living with her daughters. And they lived in Palm Beach Gardens on the other side of the state. So Sigrid was in Sarasota and they were in Palm Beach. And I'd been taking care of my dad for 10 years. And I thought, let them take care of them. So they brought them down to that side of the state.
Wait, and where did your dad live?
He lived in Gloucester with us. We lived in Gloucester, Massachusetts at the time. Okay. So we lived with him. The two of them moved in together. And then when we realized they needed some help, we rented our house and moved in with them. So we were living with them. They moved down to the assisted living in Palm Beach Gardens. And I recognized that he wasn't going to be around for much longer. And we had grown so
fond of them,
not living with them necessarily, but spending so much time with them that I had committed to myself that I wanted to see him 8 times a year. And I set that intention in January, randomly. In April, they moved down. And a year later in May, we moved down. And it was just like, okay, it'll be much easier to see them. And we also got 10 feet of snow.
Yeah, that was the contributing factor.
That was the thing that kind of did it for us. Arizona's nice, but we're too committed. But once he had to drive to work in 10 feet of snow, he was like, yep, we're out of here.
Yeah, yeah.
No time at all. And we rented because we lived in a room, basically, we didn't have much furniture. So we were able to rent a furnished house. My sister found it for us. One of her friends was not moving into it. So we were like, yeah, we'll take it for a year and see where we wanted to live. So we made a 1-year commitment to come down. We didn't have to bring our stuff because we were renting so we moved down in 2 car trips.
Mm-hmm.
We just drove down he drove down one weekend with a car full of things. And then he came back and we drove down again with the dogs that we had and a few other things. We left everything else in storage and moved down to see if we were going to like it. And then that was it.
No brainer, right?
Fell in love with it. And then over the course of that first year, brought more of our stuff down. And when our lease was up in that first house and we moved into a bigger place, then we've been here 5 years and in our second place here in Sarasota.
Yes, had a fire sale up in Gloucester. We were just like, yeah, we're selling everything. And we had gotten some advice from there are a lot of New Englanders, Massachusetts people and Rhode Island people here. New Yorkers tend to go to the East Coast,
yeah.
But Sarasota is much more Midwestern. So having been in Grinnell for so long and we met in St. Louis, we have Midwest attraction. Mm-hmm. So being in Sarasota, there are Ohio, Indiana, Wisconsin, Michigan. Mm-hmm. It's a very Midwest.
Yeah, it's the I-75 corridor coming south versus the I-95 coming from the East Coast.
I love that.
Entirely different vibe over on this side of the state.
Yes.
So interesting.
Yeah, it was.
You would recommend your side of the Gulf.
Totally.
Well, it depends on what it is that you want. If you want a little bit more, if you want to compare it to Grinnell, for instance, this is a little bit more South Campus and the East Coast is a little bit more North Campus. Right?
Love it.
It's a little chill vibe here.
One of the communities we have here in Sarasota is a very active Mennonite community from Indiana and Wisconsin.
Wow.
There's a whole section of town. And so once harvest is finished, they just jump in their fifth wheelers and come down and they winter down here in this one amazing neighborhood. Oh, but the food and the produce and the pies at those restaurants are incredible. So we're very, very happy to have the Mennonites as part of the community. The Amish, yeah.
The Amish are here as well. So they have tricycles that they ride. We don't have horse and buggies, but we've got tricycles. And so they're riding up and down the streets in their bikes and long dresses, even when it gets hot.
Oh, yeah.
I never knew that.
So, but it's a great community.
So is it a sizable Amish community?
It is quite sizable, yes.
Yeah, I would guess, I'm just making this up, but based on the size of that community in that part of town, I think 3,000 to 4,000Amish people down here in the winter. Yeah.
Wow. I didn't know that.
Nice people.
No, but it's the restaurants are great. Yeah, like he said, the pies. It's really nice to have the sort of Amish. We got one of the things I love when I've been in Amish country are the moon pies and all the baked goods. It's right here for us. It's fantastic.
Yeah, one of the local market chains is Amish owned, and it's like going to a farmer's market. It's fantastic. Mm-hmm.
I'll bet. So you guys basically uprooted your life in a short amount of time,
mm-hmm.
and you put everything in storage for what, a year, 2 years?
I would say 2 years. No, because we moved down here in 15, sold the house in 18.
Yeah, in trading terms, we kind of legged in. You know, it wasn't all at once. You know, it was a kind of phased in. But
one of the things I have to say is, as I've talked to more people who are thinking about living in different places, I really highly recommend renting for a year and just checking it out. I have another friend who moved down here and bought a house. She hates it. She hates the neighborhood that she's in. She's not happy at all. She just wishes that she was one block over. But they bought the house. They invested a lot in it. They can't really sell it. But she's not happy with what it is, that the move that she made. And she came down from Gloucester as well. And she moved to St. Pete. And she wasn't happy with the house in the neighborhood that she bought in. So I was really thrilled with our decision to test an area and live here for a year and see, really get to know which neighborhood we wanted to live in. Where we ended up moving to is further west and closer to the highway, which I did not. I lived downtown with my sister, close to the botanical gardens with Ev, which was also bike riding to downtown. And now we're 4 miles south of downtown, which it's like the boonies, but it's fantastic because we get on and off the highway easily. And we are away from, it does get people-y here in the winter because, people are coming down from the snowy climbs to even with COVID. Really? People did travel because they have homes here, right? It's not as much vacation. It's not hotel rooms. We've built a lot of hotel rooms in the last 5 years, but people have condos here that they have for generations.
Yeah, winter homes. Winter homes that they come back year after year.
Wow.
They call it in season. So basically from Thanksgiving through mid-April, the population in Sarasota explodes.
Yeah.
Now you do get some vacationers, especially during spring break time, like over on Siesta Key. But for the most part, it's actual snowbirds that are here 5 months out of the year and then go back north, because nobody wants to be here in August unless they absolutely have to be.
We've heard from a couple of other couples who have moved to Florida that the weather is just at times unbearable, but because the majority of the time is lovely, they stay. So how do you guys feel about that hot, hot weather?
Well, here's the thing. Honestly, we can afford to live in a house with a pool. And when we lived downtown, we were a mile from the beach. So we moved here. When we left Massachusetts, there was snow on the ground on May 15th. Now, it had been plowed. It was the piles of snow in the malls, right?
But snow
was there. And we got, and it was probably, let's say, 38, 40 degrees, and it was melting, right? But we got here 3 days later, and it was 90. And I was like, it's summer! This is fantastic! It's warm! and the beaches are amazing in the summer. Mm-hmm. So every day we lived we lived half a mile from the beach in Massachusetts, and I think I was at the beach twice in 24 years. It was cold. The water is cold. We moved here. We were in the beach. We were in the water every single day for the first. Nice.
Yeah, that was kind of happy hour. You know, at the end of the day, mm-hmm. we would we call it bobbing. We'd go bobbing. We'd just meet at the beach. We wouldn't even come home first. So she would leave home. I would leave work. We'd meet at the beach, and we'd just bob up to our necks in the water and dream about what we wanted to make for dinner, and then hit the market on the way home and make an amazing meal. And that would pretty much be it. My friends tease me. Especially as a musician, you'd think I would keep, you know, the later hours. No, I'm solar power.
Really?
The sun goes down, I'm done.
Right.
I like that.
You're a true Florida guy then.
But what's great is that here we have more sun in the winter too, because we're on a
lower, further south.
Because we're further south. I would say that our darkest nights in December it gets dark around maybe 5. And light around 7:30. So we still, instead of when we were in New England, it was dark at 3:30, 4 o'clock, and it wouldn't get light till 8, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
7:30, 8 o'clock. Mm-hmm. Is that, mm-hmm. yeah. So I'm assuming that's still true. So we get a little bit more like 10, 11, 12 hours in the winter.
Mm-hmm.
And because we're solar powered, it's much better for us in terms of depression and that sort of thing, because we have a lot more light. The downside is I'm a morning person, and I loved in New England in June, getting up at 4 o'clock in the morning and it appearing like it was noon.
Yeah.
Here, that's not true. It's still only light at, 5:30.
Okay.
So those summer days aren't quite as long, but I would rather have the year round light.
I'm working outside most of the time. So in those hot, sticky summer months, you just bring 3 changes of clothes. I'm doing that right now. I've been refinishing a lot of tropical hardwood docks. It's the time of year to do that. So I'm out on the barrier islands at these, $10 million mansions, redoing all their epee antique docks and furniture and pergolas. Mm-hmm. So in the mornings right now, I've got long pants and maybe a sweatshirt. But by 10 o'clock, I'm down to shorts and one of those lightweight fishing shirts.
Wow.
But in the summer, you definitely need a couple of changes of clothes as you go through.
You adjust because it sounds like you're on vacation year round. So
it's
a no-brainer.
It really feels that way. And in truth, we're in air conditioning.
Mm-hmm.
He is now working outside, but you can get a break from it. Mm-hmm. It's just like in the winter. How can you live in the cold? Well,
right.
You have heat in the house, right?
Exactly. Exactly.
And the truth is that, yes, it's oppressively hot in the summer, but I'm in my air conditioning, or I'm in the pool, or I'm at the beach with working from home. I mean, with a new dynamic, if I'm home, I'm in a climate controlled situation
most
of the time. So it doesn't matter where I live. I'd rather be warm than cold.
Absolutely. That's an excellent definition.
So did you hear him, Gil? He has to redo the epee wood all the time. Gil convinced me to get epee wood, and every 2 years I have to redo it. But it's nice.
Yeah. Unless you like it gray. Some people like the weathered gray look, and some people want that beautiful warm. And being a guitar builder and furniture builder, I'm a freak about good wood and enhancing the grain and
But that wood is so hard. It's so hard to drill into.
It's called ironwood for a reason. I snapped off 3 bits in the first 45 minutes the other day, and had some hardened bits and stainless steel star head screws. You can't even drill down into it.
Right.
To replace some dock boards, but it's beautiful stuff, and it's indestructible, and it's perfect for down here.
Yeah,
well, they have docks made of it. Wow.
Yeah.
You have a lot of money.
Square foot, three tier dock 3 weeks ago. It was about a 2 week long project of cleaning, brightening, sanding, and then oiling. But 500 square feet worth of that.
Oh my goodness.
Well, and the nice thing is, I love people who get caught up with the keeping up with the Joneses, because my clients are all very affluent. And so I do somebody's dock, and the neighbor has a similar epee or teak dock. And they're like, "Hey, Bob's looks way better than mine now. Do you have a card?"
Brilliant.
I'm getting going to get some of those yard signs made for my business, but put them out on the dock so the kayakers and the boaters see them. Now, I don't care the people out in the front. Nobody needs to see that. Yeah. But as potential clients are paddling by, they go, "Oh, that looks amazing. That's beautiful. I'll have my sign right there, facing out to the canal." So
brilliant.
Oh, that's
good,
so funny.
Good for you, man. Yeah, I love it. So tell us.
Go ahead.
No. So Sarasota has been consistently ranked number one. I mean, every time we look at another report, it's number one. How do you think it differs from the other areas that are popular or competing?
Let me take that one from the beach standpoint, why Siesta Key Beach gets rated so high all the time. The offshore is a quartz crystal deposit. Humongous one. So that beach is not crushed coral. It's not crushed shell. It's not gravelly. It's actually pulverized quartz crystal that is powder fine. It's like confectioner sugar. But they claim that there are healing properties to it, but it just, the feel of it is just so entirely different. You go a mile to the south or a mile to the north and the quality of the sand is completely different. Imagine a beach made entirely of pulverized quartz crystal. It's
unbelievable. That's why it's so white, right?
It feels completely different. It's fluffy in a weird way. I mean, it feels like the ground, but when you walk through it, it's dustier, it's finer, and it doesn't get hot.
It dissipates the heat.
It dissipates the heat, and you can walk on the beach in bare feet. So, for instance, when I go for walks on the beach, I just leave my shoes at the edge of the path at the bushes. Okay. And then it can be quite a long walk to get to the water. So, but it doesn't burn your feet because it's quartz instead of coral.
Yeah. Okay. But then another thing, and I think another component to that is for a small city, we have a ballet company, three theater companies, a performing arts center with the off-Broadway touring plays and concerts.
We have an
opera company, a very, very active live music scene. Anywhere you go, you'll get live music if you want it.
Original live music or just copy based?
Both. Yeah. Okay. It depends. You get a lot of Buffett covers, you know, if you go to a tiki bar, that's what you know, but you can find reggae, R&B, blues, Motown. I'm more Americana singer songwriter stuff. There's fantastic bluegrass circles. In fact, I'm attending a jam later on this afternoon at my neighbors and singing partners across the street. So culturally, there's a lot to offer, but also I think we have more millionaires per capita than most cities, especially in the season. You know, it's a very, parts of town are very affluent. You know, people that can afford to have vacation homes in Florida do. We have rock stars and actors and Hall of Famers that have homes here in Sarasota. And so it's not uncommon to, I think even Jerry Springer lives in town, you know, it runs the whole gamut. But I was at a New Year's Eve party a couple of years ago, geeking out with Stu Cook from Creedence Clearwater Revival.
Oh, wow.
It's like for half an hour, we're talking about guitar building. It's like, he was at Woodstock. He's in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, and we're just sharing a beer around a bonfire at a New Year's Eve party, and that's not uncommon down here.
Yeah,
and people treat our celebrities just as regular people. It's not uncommon to run into Brian Johnson from AC/DC at the supermarket.
Oh my God, Gene is salivating right now. Okay,
salivating. Hey, I have a funny story about that. One of my air conditioning tech friends. Amy Grant, Vince Gill's.
Amy Grant.
Her parents have a place down here on one of the keys. And so he goes to do a service call and Vince Gill opens the door and knows exactly who Vince Gill is, but he keeps calling him Mr. Grant. Just kind of and doesn't pretend to acknowledge or know who he is. And after about an hour or so, Vince Gill's kind of fishing for like, well, what kind of music you like there? You know, and finally, he's like, oh, really? You know Amy Grant? He's just messing with him. And you know, he finally fesses up that, you know, he knows exactly who Vince Gill is.
But that's so funny.
Yeah, they're just treated as regular folks down here because it's high per capita, you know, folks like that. But
interesting. And then, but there's also a mix, right? I mean, there are people who, I mean, is it affordable? Did you have trouble finding, you know, like middle income people who are able to purchase homes?
Yes. Mm-hmm. So I found when we moved down here that I would say compared to Boston, it was about 30% cheaper to live here. It was significant, like the grocery store, and it was easier to save money in that way. Electricity was a little bit cheaper, but you are spending more because you're doing it at, because we have a pool and a hot tub. Mm-hmm. We're spending a little bit more than maybe the average person would. But I found that it was less expensive to live here, and it was easy to find places to live. I would say that one of the downsides is that a lot of the neighborhoods are HOAs. So they're homeowner associations. So that even though you own your own home, you can't have a camper in your front yard. You can't leave a
boat or commercial vehicles.
No, what are the?
U-Haul?
Not a U-Haul, but the bins that you have to load, to store.
Oh, yeah.
Bin thing, you can't have that in your front yard. You can't have a boat in your front yard. We rent and we live in an HOA. So you can't park your car on the street overnight. You have to have it in the driveway. So I would say that for people who prefer a much more independent living style, that might be a little bit challenging here because there are more condos and sort of neighborhoods that require, but on the flip side, it keeps the neighborhoods really beautiful and it's a very attractive place to live. And another thing about Sarasota that I absolutely love, and I don't know if it's true about all of Florida, but it is true here, is that the beaches and the parking are free. In Gloucester, it's $25 to park at the parking lot. Mm-hmm. But here, all the parking is taken care of. The roads are maintained beautifully. I would say that Sarasota is a city that really takes care of itself. It's sustainable. The bus transportation is regular and works well. I was really surprised at all of the free amenities that there are, considering it's a tourist town.
Right.
That you've got so many people coming, but the.
And I think back to your question on middle income. Obviously, the closer you get to the bay and the harbor, and then the barrier islands, you know, the property values go up. Most of the people in the trades or the service industries live further inland and further south towards Venice, Inglewood, Nokomis. Like when I was managing an estate over on Lido Key, in off season, I could be there in 20 minutes. During season, it could be 45 minutes to an hour to get there. Getting off the barrier islands during the season because of beach traffic, all the beaches are out there on those keys. Mm-hmm. It could take me an hour just to get off of the islands and I'm still 45 minutes from home. So
that's amazing.
Most of the people in the trades and the service industries that service those affluent clients have to commute to be able to have affordable housing and a nice quality of life. There's almost a dividing line. You could have the same square footage house on the western side of the Tamiami Trail that would cost you twice as much as two blocks to the east of the Tamiami Trail. Yeah. They just, you know, the realtor code is, oh, well, it's west of the trail, you know, meaning closer to the beach. If you're willing to drive 45 minutes, you can live quite well and comfortably. Mm-hmm. And so that's just
45 minutes to get to the beach.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But we live west, like I said, we're 4 miles west of Siesta Key in the southern portion of Sarasota. And it's directly in line with Siesta Key. So it can take me maybe 15 minutes to get to the beach instead of walking to the beach. Yeah. Right?
And it is close enough to take a bicycle or a scooter, you know, a little Vespa-style scooter. And
those are popular down here.
Yeah.
And I have to say, it's awfully nice to have, be in a Jeep with the top down in February, you know?
Oh, wow.
Yes, it is.
I don't mind sitting in traffic.
I don't either. Yeah.
Yeah. You said you have a pool. Do you own the pool in the winter or is it too cold?
Oh, yeah.
No, we have a heated pool.
Oh, wow.
We don't heat it every day. It's expensive. I'm not going to lie. We're not, I don't love the pool so much that but we have a hot tub and we're in the hot tub probably 4 or 5 times a week. We have what we're prepping for today. And we're taking time out of our day this morning to talk to you is we do Sunday fun days. So it's naked time by the pool. We have our friends come over and it's our pod of people. And so it's a place that we can come and, because we don't want to go to the nudist resorts because of COVID. We don't want to be in the bigger.
And that's still open.
Yeah, yeah, those are still open. Wow. No, thank you.
It's outdoors and it's lovely. And I have to say that it is a little weird down here because we are diligent mask wearers. I'm a diligent hand washer. I follow all of the CDC protocols. And we've really been fine. We've eaten out in restaurants, but most of the restaurants I'm eating outdoors. We eat outdoors. Yeah. Right. I think we went to a Thai restaurant the other day. There were 2 patrons in a restaurant that holds 100 people.
Wow.
So most of the
fries are still open. Yeah.
So I don't feel uncomfortable being, and all of the utensils, the paper products, the staff were wearing masks. We don't go to restaurants where they're not wearing masks, the wait staff. I have to say, at least in Sarasota, we are part of a study from the sister study, which I was a part of, which is about breast cancer specifically.
Okay.
They partnered with Mass General and are doing a COVID study. And so we're watching the numbers and our numbers have stayed at 1% for a year.
Okay.
1%, 1.3%, but the highest we've gotten is 1.3%. They've done an excellent job down here.
Yeah.
They lifted the mask requirements downtown, but if they're not wearing masks in the stores, we won't spend our money in the stores.
Right, right, right. And so, you know, it's stupid for them. Yeah, because we know the governor hasn't enforced it, so it's up to the citizens. Yeah,
it is, and so we're doing what we can, but it also means that when we know that our friends are doing the same thing, so we've had a lot more. And because we're outdoors, we're kayaking, we're cycling, we're hanging out by the pool, we're socializing safely
outside.
And outside, and people are, you know, so we've had a little bit less of a traumatic experience through COVID. And I would say that that's mainly because we have been in Florida, that we have been able to be outside and see people and stay safe.
Downside, depending on where you fall on the spectrum, is it is Florida. It you're south of the Mason-Dixon line and it is a red state. And so I didn't realize the extent of that when we first got down here because of the people we hang out with, our fashion designers, filmmakers,
artists,
musicians. So I thought that even Sarasota was this groovy little progressive enclave. That's not the case. Now we have found the groovy progressive enclave within, but I did a stand-up comedy boot camp within the first 9 months we were down here, and it was the performance was the night after the Arizona primary. So this was 2015. And I did an all political set with an original song on my banjo. It's my banjo with the Bernie Sanders logo painted on it. And I thought I would be playing to like-minded people. And then I'm sitting there with all the other students with the owner of the club, and I'm watching folks pile in, you know, for the show. And I realized I am going to upset, I guarantee, 75% of the people at this show, which was fine as long as I knew that going in, you know. But it's a full-on red state, so you just have to know that going in.
Especially the West Coast, right?
Yeah. Yes, exactly.
It's Midwest.
The blue part of the state is definitely Fort Lauderdale on down through Miami. Bluer.
But again, one of the reasons I really loved Sarasota, my sister had always thought that maybe she'd retire in Mexico or something. And it's like, there's a place in Florida that is probably really going to be okay. And one of the reasons Sarasota was attractive, I wanted to move down here, but we weren't necessarily ready to retire. But I felt like I was too young to be spending so much time indoors alone, hibernating in the winters in Massachusetts. Thinking about coming down here, I read that the average age in Sarasota was 44 versus in Naples where it's 77.
Yeah.
Right? Because this is a much more young and vibrant city. This is a place where young people, and again, given that we're in different circumstances now, people are able to work from home. You can come to a city like this and live here and be in a vibrant and active community and not be in, and again, Bonita Springs or, you know, Naples, Fort Myers, where it's really much more a transient second home condo kind of a place. And it's really snowbirds. People are living in what they call God's waiting room. And just come down here and sort of sit in front of the television and, you know, maybe be active.
Play a little Mahjong and then die.
Okay. I have to tell you this now that you brought that up. So my poor mom had diabetes with her last child, and she lived with that for a while. Anyway, she eventually went on dialysis the last 6 years of her life. One of the things my mom enjoyed the most was Mahjong. Typical, not necessarily typical, but of that generation of immigrants, Mahjong is huge. And we're talking big dollars. All right.
You're not doing it right.
Exactly. You know, she's like, what do you mean play with the quarter? I'll play with the quarter with you kids, but that's it. So anyway, on one of the last nights, I picked her up from dialysis, dropped her off at a Mahjong place close to our house. She also ran, by the way, a Mahjong parlor for several years.
Nice.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God. She's like, I made $10,000 this month. I'm like, all right, shush. I don't want to. You know, she tells me about the business. And I'm like, Ma, I'm a lawyer. I don't need to know.
It was in Chinatown. And I came up there once. Guys ran out the fire escape because they thought I was a cop.
So cool. That was funny, right? They're like, oh my God, they look out this little window. They're like, white guy.
And she's going, no.
Easy.
Yeah. So it was her last night. I dropped her off. I never knew that I wouldn't see her again. And she was playing a game of Mahjong. She was losing, of course, in those days because, you know, her vision was going, her health just was at its worst, you know, and she had a heart attack and she died at the Mahjong.
But she died doing something she loved.
Doing what she loved.
Yes. Yeah.
Right. That's awesome.
And we get a call, you know, I got there, my brother got there, and there she was lying on the ground, and the Mahjong parlor, the people had cleared out. They were like, we don't want to be around when the cops come, you know? But anyway, I digress.
Oh, man.
But thanks, everyone, for bringing up the Mahjong.
It's a beautiful story, though. She sounded like a character.
Yeah.
Oh, she was.
Oh, she was a character with a capital C.
Nice.
Yeah. What about healthcare? How's healthcare there?
That's funny. I was just going to mention that. Another thing is I'm a non-traditional medical, I don't do Western medicine as readily as I do Eastern medicine. And so there, where we lived in Gloucester was a very early on, I was the board director on the co-op back in the like early 90s, really a little bit ahead of our time. And Gloucester was a enclave of natural healers. Reiki was very popular there, chiropractic and massage and acupuncture. Mm-hmm. I was attracted to that kind of more energy medicine. Mm-hmm. And I have to say that when we got to Sarasota, we've got fantastic healthcare. If you're looking for Western medicine, they got whatever you need. But what they also have is a lot of alternative healing. And so for people who are interested in an alternative healing, they've got really great practitioners here and many of them. Mm-hmm. Anything, you might want, however avant-garde it might seem, it seems to be here. Mm-hmm. And I really, now we have, we go to, and the other thing that they have that I have not, I've investigated but haven't engaged in is concierge medicine. So rather, you might have a catastrophic, and in this, these days, I think you can have like catastrophic insurance if you need it. But for daily stuff, you can have a membership at a doctor's office where you can just call at any time and get questions answered and go in for visits. And it's a much more cost control. Now, we also, weirdly enough, in our late 50s and early 60s, require no medication. So we have no blood pressure medicine, no anything, no prescriptions that we take on a regular basis, except for medical marijuana, which is also incredible, which has helped with my insomnia and anxiety and pain. Mm-hmm. So that has been, we have been able to find whatever it is that we need. We have an excellent Planned Parenthood organization here. I remember I went in, we lost his great health insurance when we first moved down here because he left his job. We had it for a year or whatever, and afterwards, mm-hmm. but I needed to get a mammogram. I hadn't been to the doctor for a while. And I went in and the office offered 3D mammograms for $69.
Oh, wow.
I didn't need the, it wasn't like a $400 thing that I had to pay a copay. It was $69 for a mammogram. I was like, yep,
out of pocket.
It's just out of pocket.
It's amazing. That is amazing for a 3D.
Very affordable.
Yeah. Here we have to seek it out in New York. I mean, they're all over, but you know, it's not like $69 for sure. Yeah.
No, but I was surprised that I found even the medical care affordable here.
Okay. Okay.
Which was surprising. And we have not, well, again, we don't go to the doctor. I don't go for an annual checkup. We're healthy in general. And when, but I do see a Chinese medicine doctor on a regular basis.
Right. Right.
So I would do my pap smear at Planned Parenthood and my breast exam, wherever it is that I need to go. And I'm paying for it independently and I can afford it and it's easy and I don't have to deal with insurance. So it's out of pocket, but I'm healthy and I'm able to afford it. And I feel like that is a big, big plus for people as well.
Another thing that's popular down here, which is very convenient if you just, you know, you need some stitches. I got a concussion at work a while back. I had a swarm of bees come after me, and I reared up to get away from them. I came up underneath an overhanging concrete piece, knocked myself unconscious. Let me just.
Oh my goodness!
There are a ton of urgent care facilities, which are just sort of walk-in, light emergency room. You know, you don't have to go to the hospital if you just need some stitches. You know. A finger put back in place because you dislocated, you know, but those are very popular down here too and very convenient. And you're in and out of there within an hour. You know, it might cost you $150, but you know, you walk into an emergency room, you're looking at $1,000 just for showing up.
Yeah.
You know, so those are very popular down here as well. Mm-hmm.
So Sarasota claims to be the winter home of Ringling Brothers, claims to have been the winter home of Ringling Brothers. It really was because I grew up in a town which also claimed to be the winter home of Ringling Brothers. And as a bunch of towns did. Yeah, I grew up in partly in Island Park, New York, which is in Long Island. And there was a part of town called Barnum Isle. And the myth was always that was the winter home. Well, I did some research on this. It was not. It was, in fact, somebody named Peter C. Barnum that owned the land, not P.T. Barnum. But you really live in the place that was the winter home.
Yeah. Ringling. Mr. Yes. Ringling is the guy in, I don't know, 18-something that started wintering in Sarasota.
Is that right?
Mm-hmm. Yes. So John Ringling and Marie, I can't remember his wife's name. But the museum is fantastic. It's one of the things that I do with almost everybody who visits us. I have a membership to the museum. And they have there was an artist who recreated a miniature circus. And so you walk into the museum, you walk into this particular portion of the museum, and they have a railroad cars and rails. It's an enormous room, railroad cars. And they have the animals on the railroad cars. And then you walk down a little bit further and you show them unpacking the railroad cars and setting up the food tents. And it tells a story of, so as you walk around this room, you see the progression of how the circus is created, unpacked, and then packed back up and enjoyed, and the people coming in, and there's the, what's
the midway.
Yeah.
You can see the animals and the petting zoo, mm-hmm. and the bearded lady and the, you know,
yeah,
all the different attractions. And that is absolutely and it's a miniature and it's fantastic. It's just beautiful to see.
Wow.
The gardens are beautiful. Their home was right on the bay. It's gorgeous. And they do tours there as well. We have quite a few attractions that were created by Ringling. He, on Long Lido Key, mm-hmm. he built the Ringling Bridge, is named for him. His statues from his own collection pepper the central common area, St. Armand's Circle. I think it's St. Armand's Circle. And there is our own Hollywood stars mm-hmm. are,
but for circus performers.
But for circus performers,
Circus Hall of Fame.
It's a Circus Hall of Fame. Walk around. I think, is it Dumbo?
Oh yeah.
There's a wheel for all of the famous clowns and artists that you've heard of in your lifetime. Yeah.
Now, my favorite thing about them being down here, there's a fraternal organization similar to the Elks or the Moose Lodge, but for show folks, for old circus people, and it's called Show Folks, and it's their private club. But there was a neighborhood, and there were a couple of these on our street when we first moved here, that were tiny houses that were built to scale for the little people that were part of the circus. Oh, and so the doors are lower, the counters are lower, the toilets are lower. So they're full-sized houses if you happen to be 4 foot tall. And they've moved a couple of them out because now they're in very desirable neighborhoods. Yeah. But these cottages were amazing. And you might get four of them on one lot.
Wow.
Just adorable. They're almost like dollhouses, but they were for small human beings.
Wow. So that's still in existence.
Yes.
I'm saying, but some of it moved away. Okay. Okay. Yeah.
Well, no, there's still a winter. There's the circus. What's it called? The Circus Conservatory.
Yes,
so they have classes for people who want to try trapezing and try learning mm-hmm. things. They have a kids circus and we have circus events all year long and small circuses that set up and mm-hmm. tents go up and come down.
Yeah.
And it's really still quite active.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess the circus ended, right?
Right.
A few years ago.
Yeah.
They fired the entire circus.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I believe many of the performers may have come back here. I know mm-hmm. some of the animals are in Central Florida. There's a refuge for the circus animals.
Yeah.
In fact, Nick Walinda, one of the Flying Walindas, lives here in town.
Yeah.
And he's doing a drive-in stunt show at Benderson Park right now. So you and you view all of these stunts from your car. COVID-safe.
Yeah.
Stunt show with Nick Walinda doing the high wire thing as the finale. But
so great.
Oh my goodness.
We have a water ski show
at the aquarium.
At the aquarium.
Very
wow.
Yeah, I'll bet.
The pyramid, with all the
I love this kitschy stuff. Yeah.
It's really fantastic. It's wonderful.
Ringling Brothers and Barnum and Bailey joined. So Barnum probably did start in Long Island.
No, he didn't. No. There was a different.
It wasn't
P.T. Barnum. It wasn't P.T. Barnum. It was Peter C. Barnum.
Okay.
This myth just accelerated over the years.
Okay.
And it wasn't true at all.
Sure.
Yeah. And I think Hartford, Connecticut.
True at all.
Interesting.
Yes.
Connection to P.T. Barnum.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. And
this was Ringling. And even their The Greatest Show on Earth, the Barnum and Bailey Ringling Brothers, were not headquartered out of Sarasota, I think for about 12 years before they had changed logistically where this was their headquarters, but that did change.
I mean, it's quite the presence, I bet, in Sarasota. Oh, yeah. Because
of Ringling College, which is one of the...
Ringling College.
Yeah. Art and design. They're actually kind of their specialty is movie animation. They're almost a trade school for companies like Pixar and DreamWorks.
Yeah.
Oh, interesting.
Very, very high-end design college, but digital animation and media and game development is one of their specialties.
This is a really very, very arts centric.
I have just a quick question back to the beaches. How's the fishing there?
Oh, fantastic. Except when we had red tide a couple of years ago, that was catastrophic. But no, I have several friends that are charter fishing captains. And yeah, if you like offshore fishing, mm-hmm. Either in the flats or going offshore,
there's a lot of opportunity.
It's heaven for that down here. And there's obviously a huge boating scene. Mm-hmm. So both mm-hmm. sail and power yachts, they're just within the four or five towns up and down the coast, there must be a dozen different yacht clubs and boat clubs. One of the things we love, they also have several really good boat rental clubs. You don't need to own your own boat.
Wow.
You just pay a monthly fee. You get so many days worth of usage. And so we'll rent a boat a couple of times a year, usually a pontoon boat, just get a bunch of friends and
of course, we haven't done that recently because too close quarters.
Yeah. But yes, there's an extremely active fishing and boating component to living down here.
And so the seafood must be really good, huh?
Yes.
I will say, though, that I was quite surprised how expensive it was. We lived in, again, Gloucester, Massachusetts,
yeah.
fishing town. You know, you could get lobsters for $2.99 a pound, right? It was
wow.
But down here, first of all, it's different fish, which also is kind of eye-widening. The fish is delicious, but I would say that it isn't nearly as popular as I expected it to be. I thought I'd be eating fish all the time. It's not as on as many restaurant menus as I would have expected it to be on.
God, that's really surprising.
I think one of the reasons for that is the type of fish that's down here all has to be caught on lines as opposed to in nets. Oh, and so the amount of work and effort going into each individual fish landed is considerably higher than, say, up in Gloucester where you're getting cod by the ton.
Mm-hmm. That's a good point. But the other thing is that another interesting fact was that Florida has a high per capita. It's an agriculturally more cattle driven state than a fishing state.
Mm-hmm. I wouldn't have known that.
Yeah, Central Florida.
You wouldn't have known this at all. So when my dad was alive and in Palm Beach, we would drive from Sarasota to Palm Beach, which is almost directly across the state. And you're just going through cattle country. I think we learned that Florida has more cows per capita than Texas.
What?
Wow.
The whole center of the state is very cattle driven.
Wow.
Yeah. So wow. The three main agricultural parts of the state is citrus, cattle, and sugar down around Okeechobee. You know mm-hmm. the
wow. Oh, imagine those poor cows. They're used to, you know, the cows that we see in the Northeast where they get mm-hmm. snow and then all of a sudden they're in 90 degree weather, those cows. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Getting together, yeah. It's like you must sweat a lot.
we had there's been a lot of building here because obviously with all these fantastic reviews and beaches, we've got a lot of growth happening right now. Longhorn steer grazing on our corner.
Right across the street from the grocery store.
Yeah, right across the street from the grocery store.
It's about a 3-acre pasture because the part of town we live in is called Palmer Ranch, and it was owned by the Palmers, and it was a 10,000 acre cattle ranch. But they still have little pastures where they will graze the cattle, and they move them from pasture to pasture. So it's not surprising to be driving around in Sarasota and pass some longhorns out in a fenced off pasture.
Interesting, because when you look at the Google images of certain zip codes and all, you don't see cattle, right? Anytime you Google Sarasota, it's the beaches. And I would have never even thought about this.
Yes, but it also means
cool.
have access to grass-fed beef and wild hogs. There's a market for people who want to buy, if you're eating meat, you can have a buy half a cow or whatever. There's a lot of organic stuff happening here too. So we have a fantastic farmers market. We belong to a CSA and we get our box every week. That runs from November 1st to June 1st, I think. And then we've started growing a few vegetables ourselves in little grow boxes that we got at Home Depot. And it's interesting to have to learn when to grow things because it's a different season when you've got sun all year.
Right.
But as a chef, it's nice to have an herb garden that I've got all year long. I just go out and my basil and my thyme. And
I have a question about Sarasota sounds beautiful and wonderful and there's so much to do. But I read there's some areas that have some crime. Is that correct?
Yeah, like any city, the closer you get to the town of Bradenton, which is the next one north of us, just like any city, you have rougher parts of town, you know, and economically depressed areas, and that leads to crime and drugs, and definitely a factor. I don't think it's any worse than anywhere else, but there are definitely parts of town you want to lock up your car.
And we do have a high homeless population in season because they'll go back up north in the summers. Even the homeless tend to be seasonal in terms of quantity.
I would do that too if I were in that situation. Yeah. I would at least, if I were a professional camper, as some people call it, I'd want to be someplace warm too.
So there are homeless snowbirds?
There are homeless that may be an unfair characterization. I will say that the homeless population does go up in the winter and goes down in the summer. And I think it's because and think about it, it's unbearable to be outside in the summer here.
Yes.
So you would want to go to cooler climes and spend the summer someplace else.
Not just homeless, but a lot of people are very fond of Asheville, the Smoky Mountains. So people they'll go up to they'll have a place up in the mountains for July, August, and September. So they're out of the heat and humidity, and also out of here for hurricane season, because that is a factor. Sarasota, just because of geographically where we are, hasn't had a direct hit by a hurricane since the 30s. Even the ones that loop around, they'll either hit north of us and hit Tampa, or they'll go in at Punta Gorda south of us. But just, you know, they follow the hot water just because of where Sarasota is. The only ones that are a real threat are the ones that brew in the Gulf, that just pop up. And those are a little more unpredictable. And that's usually not till September or October. So even for hurricanes, I would rather be in Sarasota than in Tampa or south of us, or in Miami, Homestead, or the Keys.
Some people posit that maybe it's the crystal deposit that Sarasota. But what I can tell you is we have a lot of old trees, which you don't find in
because
of the hurricanes.
Right.
Have you ever had to evacuate?
No, but when Irma came through 4 years ago, her sister and their family evacuated to us. We're 7 miles inland, and in all the different evacuation zones, our house sits on level 5, and we've got acres of preserve right behind us that are level 4. They're at a lower elevation. So both for wind and tidal storm surge, we're golden. And our neighborhood was built after Hurricane Andrew. They strengthened the new home construction zoning and rules, so all of our utilities are underground. They call the houses that we're in Category 3. You can go through a Category 3 without boarding up. They're designed for that, and that's not the case everywhere. But we're in a neighborhood that was built after they had stricter hurricane building codes. A popular building material is cinder block here, cinder block and metal roofs.
Oh wow.
For both the insulation property, and they can take the winds. And there's an entire line of ballistic glass. So you can build a house now to withstand Category 4 hurricanes and not even have to board up. They're just designed to take that into consideration.
Wow.
So if we were going to build new, that's the direction we would go.
That's great to know. My sister was saying that they were looking for land in
Delaware.
Delaware.
By the ocean.
By the ocean. And they learned that you always look for property where there are a lot of trees, old trees. The older trees, the better, right? Mm-hmm. And you don't really instinctively think that that's where you want to build, because you have to cut all that down if you want to build a home. But that's a great sign. Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, I'm learning a lot every day.
A factor in Florida is sea rise. In downtown Sarasota, new moon and full moon, you might get some water in the streets, kind of like Venice.
Oh, wow.
Not often. I mean, if in a storm surge, right? It's not right. like tides come into the streets, but in a in a heavy storm, it's possible to get a few inches of water downtown.
It's not as bad as Miami, is it?
No, but we've had days. Miami is in much worse shape. Yeah. But people that want to retire to Florida, it's something that needs to be considered if you're going to build close to the ocean.
Yeah.
Do the on stilts where you've got flow through down below, storage, garage, but no living quarters on the first floor and have everything up higher, because that's the world we live in, and I don't see it getting any better anytime soon.
No, definitely not.
Okay, so we've taken up a lot of your time.
Great.
Anything else that we missed or you might want to add? Anything?
No, I would just also say that if somebody's thinking about retiring, I encourage you to, if it's possible, and you can now are working from home, to consider retiring earlier, not retiring earlier, but moving earlier to the place where you want to retire.
Yes.
Because again, we have an incredibly much more active lifestyle than we had when we lived in Massachusetts. Mm-hmm. And it's because we have the ability to be outside, many more activities that we have access to. And we didn't have children. So it's kind of nice to be in an area that doesn't have a ton of kids, because a lot of people who are here are older adults who are retiring, and their kids are living someplace else, empty nesters, right? Mm. So for adults, it's a great community. But I worked for a very short time for the Boys and Girls Club too. They do have great facilities for kids here. So even if you still have young kids, again, the average age is 44. Wow. So you can come and check it out, raise your kids here and retire here.
That's a great point.
Fully prepared, right? Because this is really just a terrific city, and the people are great and the services are good. And
no state income tax. And so if you are still working.
That's important. That's
it's
important.
Like a 20% raise right there.
Yeah. I like looking at that point. Yeah. Okay, yeah, good. That's good. All right. Well, thank you guys so much.
Yeah. Thank you
really
so much.
Really made Sarasota sound like the number one place.
Yeah.
Come down and visit, because we do have extra guest rooms.
Okay. I'm going to take you up on that, Lisa, but I'm not taking off my clothes. I'm going to tell you right now.
Fair enough.
Okay. I'm going to tell you that right now in advance.
It is clothing optional. It is clothing optional in the house. If you don't care that I'm naked, I'm totally fine with you wanting
it. It's the type A New Yorker Brooklyner that I am. I lock my doors. Lock my clothes on, and that there you go. But seriously, it sounds amazing, and Gene loves the circus and anything surrounding it. All right, thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Take care. Have a good day. I hope we didn't take too much time.
No, not at all.
All right, bye. Talk to you soon. Brooklyn bye-bye. Tech,
yay!
We hope you enjoyed our show. If you know of someone who relocated for retirement and wishes to share their story, please reach out to us. We'd love to hear from you. Our email address is gg@retirethere.com. Our website is retirethere.com. And you may follow us on Twitter @retirethere_. Don't leave out that underscore. And if you liked our show, please subscribe and rate it in Apple Podcasts. We'd really appreciate it. In the meantime, be well.